Hello everybody, welcome back to the channel. In this video, we will explore a proof of the Basel problem. Now, for those of you who are unfamiliar with the Basel problem, it was proved by Euler in about 1730, and it states that the sum from n is equal to 1 to infinity of 1 over n squared is equal to pi squared divided by 6. For the more adept among you, you will also recognize that this is the Riemann zeta function evaluated at 2. So this is a bit of a strange problem because this sum converges to this very, very slowly, frustratingly slowly, but it does eventually converge to pi squared over 6. So how do we go about proving this almost magical conjecture? Well, we begin by considering sine of x. We've seen it 100 times before, and we're going to consider its Maclaurin expansion. We have x minus x cubed over 3 factorial plus x to the 5 over 5 factorial minus, and so on and so forth. The first thing that we're going to do is divide by x. So we have that sine of x divided by x. This is 1 minus x squared over 3 factorial plus x to the 4 over 5 factorial minus, and so on. Now this equation here, this is important, so we're going to put a little box around that, but for the time being, forget it. We'll come back to it when we need it. Because now we're going to look at another expansion for sine of x, using something called the Weierstrass factorization theorem. We can write a function as a product of its roots. If we consider sine of x, we have roots here, 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 and so on. In other words, we know that sine of x is equal to 0 when x is equal to 0 plus or minus pi, plus or minus 2 pi, plus or minus 3 pi, and so on and so forth, for all integer multiples of pi. Okay? When x is equal to n pi for n in z. Zahlen, integers, German for numbers. Okay? So why is this useful? Well, it means we can write sine of x is equal to x, x plus pi, x minus pi, x plus 2 pi, x minus 2 pi, and again, so on and so forth. And again, we'll divide both sides by x. And we get that sine of x divided by x is equal to x plus pi, x minus pi, x plus 2 pi, x minus 2 pi. And again, this is an infinite product. Now, we see we have pairs of things that we multiply. So what we're going to do is multiply this pair, then multiply this pair, and see if we can detect a pattern. So x plus pi, x minus pi. Immediately, we recognize that this is just a difference of two squares. This is equal to x squared minus pi squared. And again, x plus 2 pi, x minus 2 pi. This is equal to x squared minus 4 pi squared. And again, for any n, we have x plus n pi, x minus n pi is equal to x squared minus n squared pi squared. And this is just a property of the difference of two squares. Nothing particularly difficult or challenging. But now I'm going to make another observation. Just consider this example up here. We know that x squared minus pi squared is equal to 0. Of course, when x is equal to pi. But we can actually factor this. We can't factor out x because x is the variable. But we can factor out a constant. Because by its very nature, it's not a variable, it's a constant. So if we factor out minus pi squared, it's not that we're unable to factor out x squared, it's just that for what comes next, we're better off just leaving it alone. We can take minus pi squared outside of 1 minus x squared over pi squared is equal to 0, and then just divide through by pi squared. And in fact, this we can do for every single one of these. So if we go back up here, we can actually rewrite this sum and investigate the result that follows. Sine of x over x is equal to 1 minus x squared over pi squared. 1 minus x squared over 4 pi squared. 1 minus x squared over 9 pi squared. And again, this infinite product continues. And now you might start to notice, well, we've got 1 times pi squared, 4 times pi squared, you know, 1 squared, 2 squared, 3 squared, etc. So you might start to notice a pattern here. Now, I'm going to multiply this and this and see what we get. So 1 minus x squared over pi squared times 1 minus x squared over 4 pi squared. And this is 1 into 1 minus x squared over 4 pi squared minus or plus minus x squared over pi squared into 1 minus x squared over 4 pi squared. And this is, of course, 1 minus x squared over 4 pi squared minus x squared over pi squared plus x to the power 4 divided by 4 pi to the 4. Now, if you notice, when we have 1 times something, we preserve everything that's inside our bracket. After all, 1 is the multiplicative identity. So why am I mentioning this? Well, because we will always have 1 times the next step that would come would be 1 minus x squared over 9 pi squared. So what we will have is we will, in essence, conserve this 1 minus x squared over 9 pi squared. So what we'll actually get is something that looks a little bit like this. For this expansion, sine of x over x, we will get sine of x divided by x is equal to 1 minus x squared times, remember, if we just factor out these x squareds, x squared over 1 over pi squared plus, remember this is minus, we've taken out the minus x squared, this is minus x squared over 4 pi squared minus x squared over pi squared. So if we just factor out the minus x squared, 1 plus 1 over 4 pi squared plus 1 over 9 pi squared plus so on. And then we have plus, minus, and then this would be plus. Plus some, could be, it will be a constant, but it will be some alpha times x to the 4 minus, and so on and so forth. But this is important, because this kind of looks like the sum that we're looking for. And what's more, we already have, hint hint, an expression. And look at this, we have x squared over 3 factorial. So what can we conclude? Well, these two definitions, our expansion for sine of x down here, and our expansion for sine of x up here, well, they absolutely must be equivalent. There's no way that they can't be. They must be. So if we compare coefficients for expansion 1 and this is expansion 2, then what we have is that the coefficient for x squared on this one, on this expansion, is 1 over 3 factorial, is 1 over 6. So x squared over 6 must be equal to x squared times 1 over pi squared plus 1 over 4 pi squared plus 1 over 9 pi squared and so on. And so by comparing these coefficients, it must follow, therefore, that 1/6 is equal to 1 over pi squared plus 1 over 4 pi squared plus 1 over 9 pi squared, and so on and so on. And lastly, it follows then, if we multiply both sides by pi squared, we arrive at our final equation, that pi squared over 6 is equal to 1 plus 1 quarter plus 1 ninth plus and so on, which is of course equal to the sum from 1 to infinity of 1 over n squared.